Thank you very much for the introduction. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Now I'll primarily discuss the situation on lung cancer screening in Europe. These are my disclosures, and one that's not on here, but I am part of the Nelson study. So lung cancer is still one of the major problems in oncology. The American Cancer Society showed in its recent estimates from 2018 that both in men and women, lung cancer is number two in terms of numbers of new cases per year. And in both genders, lung cancer is the major mortality cause in oncology. The problem, one of the major problems in lung cancer, is that most people that present with symptoms are already in an advanced stage where we can no longer have a curative treatment. What we intend to do with screening is detect the cancer in such an early stage that we can still have a curative resection. And what we're aiming for is not only that there are less serious consequences, but also that there's less mortality due to lung cancer and a prolonged survival. Well, basically, if you want to really show this, you need randomized controlled trials. But the first evidence that lung cancer screening by low-dose CT can actually work comes from a non-randomized study, the LCAP study in New York, that already published in 2006 its first results with already a follow-up of 10 years. And they showed in more than 30,000 individuals, long-term smokers, that 75% of the cancer cases that were detected are in stage one. And nearly all of them could be resected. And you see here the survival over 10 years, 92% of those in stage one cancer. And this is a major difference to what we encounter in clinical practice. Well, since then, quite a number of studies have been performed in a randomized fashion, either comparing low-dose CT to no screening or to chest X-ray, all across the world, basically. And some are smaller, some are larger, some have a longer-term follow-up, some have more screenings, some have one screening, but all of these studies show that when you do low-dose CT screening, the percentage of cases in stage one is very high. Overall, 65% of all the cancer cases found with low-dose CT is in stage one, and nearly all of them are resectable. The largest studies so far are the US trial, the NLST, the National Lung Screening Trial, and in Europe, it's a Nelson trial. And I'll focus mainly on these two in the remainder. The interest in lung cancer screening has really peaked since the publication of the NLST results in New England in 2011. And probably you're aware of this study because it's a real game changer. In this study, 53,000 individuals were randomized one-to-one to either chest X-ray or CT. And all these individuals were long-term smokers. By 6.5 years, the number of cases of lung cancer was much higher for the low-dose CT group. And importantly, the mortality due to lung cancer was lower in the low-dose CT group. Actually 20% less mortality due to lung cancer. And since then, in the US, multiple societies have started to recommend screening in long-term smokers. Well, in the US, this is primarily opportunistic screening. And in Europe, the more common approach to screening is a government-supported program. But in Europe, we do not have yet large-scale lung cancer screening. One of the challenges that we're facing, at least until recently, but I'll get there in a minute, is that so far we did not have any European trials that showed a significant mortality benefit due to screening. Even when some Italian trials were pooled, in this case the Dante and Mild trial, with a median follow-up of by now 8.2 years, they did show a trend towards reduced lung cancer mortality, but again, this did not reach statistical significance. So far, the consensus documents that we do have, an ESR ESR ERS paper and a position statement from multiple lung cancer screening researchers, MPIs, they do suggest there's great potential and that we should start prepare for it, but that at this moment we do not have all questions answered. And some of the questions are, which optimal nodule management protocol should we use? Why is this an important topic? Well, here you see just four different examples of individuals, screenees, long-term smokers, and nearly all of them have at least one lung nodule. And many of them are small, and we need to find the one out of the 100 that is cancer. And how do we do that? Well, in the NLST and in other studies, they used a diameter-based approach, in which in NLST, all nodules that were at least four millimeter were a positive test result, which unfortunately meant that one out of four screenees had a positive test, 24.2%. And nearly all of them became part of the clinical system and had to go for follow-up, for workup, etc. And of course, in a screening setting, at least in a European way of thinking, this is not sustainable for the healthcare system. Particularly because only one out of 24 of these cases turned out to have lung cancer. So the positive predictive value was only 4%. But based on more results from the NLST, they were able to improve and optimize their nodule diameter-based protocol. And you can look this up on the ACR website. It's called LungRADS, and it has different categories. I show you here for the solid nodules, what to do in what diameter. And what you see is that they have now increased the lower cutoff for repeat CT scanning to 6 millimeters. And also for growth, this is determined on the basis of diameter. And here the growth criterion is 1.5 millimeter increase. And if their nodules are larger, there is the recommendation for direct workup. This approach was validated in a national lung screening trial, and indeed it worked to reduce the false positive rate and the overall positive rate. However, also the sensitivity for lung cancer itself went down from 94% to 79 to 85. And this is a really unwanted effect, because this is a very important feature that determines the outcome of lung cancer screening. What did we do different in the Nelson trial? This trial was started in 2003, and at that time we had the first CT scanners that allowed isotropic voxel calculation. So we were able for the first time to look at flammography of lung nodules. So instead of looking just at a 2D measurement, we were able to do semi-automated flammography. Also, this allowed us to calculate the volume doubling time as a more sensitive approach to look at growth. And instead of only looking negative and positive tests, there was an indeterminate test result in which a short-term follow-up CT was performed. This shows the overview of the trial. In total, 16,000 individuals were randomized into either screening or no screening. Again, these were long-term smokers. And one of the distinguishing features of the Nelson trial is that it changed the intervals between screenings from 1 to 2 to 2.5 years. And this was primarily aimed to investigate the impact on staging. We had a very standardized approach, starting with 16 detector CT scanner, later on with 64 in low dose setting. Well, one additional point about volumes and diameters. When you want to look at growth, and we use a minimum of 25% of volume increase to determine growth, you can already detect growth from 80 to 100 cubic millimeters. That is an increase of 25%. But when you look in this schematic overview, the increase in diameter is less than 0.5 millimeters. And that's not something we can accurately measure. On the other hand, when you're looking at an increase of 1.5 millimeters in diameter, here in the lower example, then you're talking about near increase in doubling of the volume. So this is one of the underlying principles why diameter measurements are less sensitive for growth. So when we compare the diameter approach to a volume approach, which by now has also been implemented in, for example, the UK trial, UKLS, and in the Danish lung cancer screening trial, the baseline percentage of positive cases is only 2.6%. And this is much more possible in a screening setting than, of course, 24. And then when you're looking at the number of cases of positive test results that turn out to have lung cancer, the positive predictive value is 42%. Just a couple of cases. This is a baseline case. Directly, of course, a large-scale tumor visible, and this was still stage one cancer that could be resected. And in total, 1.6% of all individuals had a baseline nodule of this size, and the positive criterion was 500 cubic millimeters or more. What's important to realize is that when lung cancer screening will be introduced, everyone will just have one baseline screening, but after that, we'll be doing all these incident screenings. And on the incident screening, you can see new nodules. And this was one case in the third round where a new nodule was found, a diameter of 10 millimeters and a volume of 250, so to say. And we did a short-term follow-up. And you can see here that the diameter is basically unchanged, but the volume has nearly doubled. So this was a fast-growing nodule that turned out, again, to be stage one lung cancer, could be resected. And I think this is a clear example how a diameter can miss growth and that we need to do longer follow-up to be sure that a nodule grows when we look just at diameters. And the third case, this was a screenee who had a new lung nodule in the second round. It looks rather irregular and suspicious. A short-term follow-up was performed, and then the nodule had disappeared. And this is not uncommon. In 10% of all cases of nodules, they are disappeared, even many at the short-term follow-up. So this is a very reassuring finding. Well, based on all the results of the screening results and the diagnosis of lung cancer, it is possible to optimize the criteria. Just like the NLST did with the lung rats, we try to optimize the workup for lung nodules. And the first important point is that when an individual did not have any lung nodule in the baseline screening, they did not have basically any risk of getting lung cancer in the next 2 years. So this suggests that perhaps in the future, when we start implementation, there may be an individualized screening interval which could be based on the baseline screening. And this is really at this moment a hot topic. On the other hand, we use criteria of 50 to 500 cubic millimeters to determine whether a repeat CT was needed or direct referral. And that could be optimized to 100 and 300. And these criteria have already been implemented as suggestions in the European position statement that was published 2 years ago in Lancet Oncology. And so this is for baseline screening. For incident screening, we see new nodules in about 11% of all screenees. And what is important to realize is that because we know within what time frame this nodule developed started to become visible, these are, in principle, all fast-growing nodules. And we've seen that the cancer risk in those kind of nodules is much higher, 6 times higher. And this necessitates lower cutoff values for repeat scanning and workup. So, based on these second, third screening rounds, the suggestion is that already between 30 and 200 cubic millimeters, which of course are very small nodules, we will need to do a follow-up CT to determine whether they're growing or perhaps disappearing. And above 200 cubic millimeters, the recommendation on incident screening is to refer for workup. So how does this volumetric approach impact the lung cancer screening outcome? And it's my pleasure to share with you the results that were first presented at the World Lung Cancer Conference last year, where first of all, and these are results for men, the screen arm showed many more lung cancer cases than in the control arm. This is not unlike NLST. But the number of cancer deaths was much lower in the screen group. And the mortality reduction was even higher than in the NLST, namely 26%. And interestingly, although the trial was not powered for women, and there were quite a small number of women in the trial, the results suggest that in women, the screening may even be more efficient and have a more positive outcome than in men. And this did not reach statistical significance, but there was a trend towards even lower mortality in women. One of the issues that is now being debated in Europe is if there's a possibility to have a more effective inclusion criteria set. Because the NLST and Nelson study, they just use a combination of age and peg years. But the Penkin trial in Canada and the UK screening used a model that allowed to identify those who are actually at higher risk and also allow to find individuals that have a risk of lung cancer but are not part of this common set based on age and gender, age and peg years. So probably with this kind of risk model, we can have less screenees, but in those who are screened, a higher probability of lung cancer. There's one thing that is of extreme importance to realize. The most effective risk reduction for lung cancer is not screening, but stop smoking. And today, there's evidence from the Italian trials that suggests that the risk of getting lung cancer and being detected with lung cancer in the trial is much higher in current smokers compared to former smokers, and is also higher depending on the number of peg years. And I think this is also really important for the lung cancer screening implementation. The UK trial found that the smoking cessation rate was higher in those who underwent CT screening. So this may well present the smokers with a teachable moment to really make the choice to stop. And when we're looking at the lung cancer probability for current and former smokers, and also by how long ago the screenees stopped smoking, we see that the effect of stopping smoking is even higher than screening itself. It's about 40% reduction of lung cancer probability. Well, one point that, of course, is also a matter of great debate is cost. At this moment in Europe, that's discussed on a national basis particularly, there's a lot of discussion about who's going to pay for CT screening. This is just an overview of all kinds of studies. I won't go into detail on all of them. For the cost related to CT screening per quality adjusted life year saved. And here highlighted are costs for the Great Britain and the US for lung screening on the left and osimertinib as immunotherapy on the right. And as you can see, for all the cases involved, the screening costs are much lower than the immunotherapy cost. About 5 to 10 times more cost effective than immunotherapy. So I think the question should rather be, can we afford not to have CT screening? So how do we go from here? And this is just a perspective from Europe. At this moment, in all the in all the European countries, there is a lot of discussion, debate on when, if, and how to implement lung cancer screening. What is important is that we have a standardized CT protocol, both for the scanning but also for the evaluation. And of course, we need to have cost-effectiveness analyses to determine which group of individuals should be screened. The expectation is that overall there will be annual CT screening, possibly in mobile units, and probably they're going to be called health units. And it's extremely important to combine it with stop smoking interventions. The result of lung cancer screening will be an enormous increase in workload for radiologists that we should all prepare for. Hopefully, we can also include AI evaluations as part of that, part of reducing that workload, but it will also affect a lot of other physicians around us. Thank you for your attention.